What is it? All fussy new music. You want to jump up in here? Quickly then. He's Scruff. What are we going to say about the Diamond Label write-up? Oh, right then. Oh, just like chill out in the way, is it? Is it like that, is it? Cheeky boy. Come on then, let's go. Oh, I got you. Oh, I got you. Oh, I got you. My little man. So, Demo? That's my name. Demo Label Writer. What was I going to say? So, I was Demo Label Writer. Demo Label Writer. Yes, the Demo Label Writer is absolutely fantastic. I've had mine since 2016. Anyway, let's get into professional mode. The Demo Label Writer. The Demo Label Writer 4XL is by far the best option for professional and home office eBay sellers, Amazon sellers, Etsy sellers, anyone who wants to print high quality postal labels quickly and reliably without having to buy expensive proprietary labels which some other brands will force you to buy. In fact, that's one tactic a lot of brands will use. They'll rope you into the low-cost printer and then stick you with expensive consumables that you can only use, so the printer is fixed so that you can only use their consumables. The Demo Label Writer 4XL doesn't have that feature, and you can use almost any size label from third-party suppliers, keeping your consumable costs quite low. Today, I'm going to show you just how easy it is to set up on Windows, and I'm going to show you the different ways you can print to the printer and get the best results, and to accommodate your workflow. Specifically, sometimes you may want to print an image where you'll want to adjust the scale but keep the ratio of your print. And sometimes you'll be printing text on your label, which will dynamically word wrap your text so that it conforms to the size of your chosen label. So my goal here is to show you how easy it is to use either method with all of the customization features you may want to use at a later date. Long story short, yes, this is the printer for you. It's USB, so it works with PCs, laptops, MacBooks, iMacs, Windows or macOS. It comes with its own power supply, so it's not going to be drawing power from the USB ports. It's extremely fast, which you'll see in a few moments. It's cheap to run with no ink cost at all, because it's thermal. And you don't have to buy the Demo branded labels, so you can virtually use any cheap thermal labels and it'll work just fine. My Demo Label Writer 4XL came with the driver disc, but you can be certain that the software is immediately out of date as soon as the printer hits the shelves. So let's download the latest version from the official Demo website and run through the installer. Okay, so I've opened up Google and typed in Demo Label Writer software drivers, and the first one that comes up is the .com. I might go to the UK one, second one down. The latest software and drivers for all label writers and label managers. Well, it's this is the one we need. Windows Demo Connect for Windows. Let's download that. It's 285 megabytes. So once that's downloaded, we can run through the installer and get it set up. Whilst that's downloading, we can set up the labels. So obviously this is mine, I've used it since 2016 and I'm really happy with it. So the most popular labels are of course going to be the 4x5s, was it 4x6? These ones, I think this is the largest size it can handle. So let's open it up and we look at that circular arrow there to know which way it should be fed. So with this spool, only one side pops off, it just sort of pulls off like that. And we're going to put the labels on this way because, like a toilet roll, it comes out that way and it needs to marry up with this arrow here. So it wouldn't be that way, it would be this way. And I'm going to hold it upright like that. And what I'm going to do with this is push this back on. There's like a spring thing in the middle. So I'm just going to push that down until it makes another click like that. And I know then that it's pretty safe, it's not going to come loose, maybe one notch down, but that's fine as long as it's not sort of dangling all over the place. And you can only put this in one way because it's small on that end and larger on the other end, so it won't go in the wrong way. And just like that, and then that goes in to the groove that's in there. Now if this was powered up, I think it would take that in. I'm just going to move this lever up like that, push it in just a little bit until it stops. And there you go. So I'm not going to put power into the printer or connected to the USB until the drivers are installed. So that gives it a chance to have a clean installation. It just so happens I've never installed this printer on this computer before, so this is generally the first time it's been installed on this computer. So now I can see that it's finished downloading. Let's open that up and see how it goes. Okay, well this is new to me, I haven't seen this before, but it's detected that it requires some additional software to be installed in the background, something called Bonjour 64. Actually, the only time I've heard that is in Apple computers. I don't know if you can see, but this is indeed an iMac, but this is all Windows-based, so that's pure coincidence. I've got Windows installed on this iMac, so essentially we can treat this as a PC. As far as everything here is concerned, it's a Windows computer. So to progress, I'm just going to click install, and by the looks of it, it'll install this required Bonjour by itself. That appeared to be successful. Alright, let's just click next. I always like to click custom, just so I can see what my options are. I'll probably end up selecting everything anyway. That all looks good, so I'm just going to press next and install. What's the matter? You cheeky girl. Don't say hello to everyone, do you? I'm busy. What do you want? Can we tweet you my pie? Yeah. No, don't drink my coffee. You won't like it. You want some fast, yeah? Want some fast, yeah? Hello, my little black void. Are you my little black void? Going. Don't go all the way in there. Yeah, I'm gonna carry on. Are you gonna behave? Don't eat that now. Come on, you. Yeah. Come on, then, let's go. Good girl. So, now that it has finished, I'm going to untick Improved Dymo Products. Who wants to improve Dymo Products? We can see how well that went with the LabelWriter 5XL. If you're thinking about getting the LabelWriter 5XL, don't. I'm going to be doing a separate review video on it. I don't have one here to test yet, and I've never had my hands on one. But from what I can tell, you have to use Dymo labels with it, because there's some kind of chip inside here that connects to the printer and tells the printer, hey, this is a Dymo set of labels, and then it works. And if it doesn't have that chip in it, apparently, I haven't checked it yet, apparently it won't print. So you can't use cheap third-party labels. I'm in the process of, in fact I did it this morning, I've asked Dymo to send me a LabelWriter 5XL for review purposes, so we're waiting to hear back about that, see how that goes. So let's launch Dymo Connect. Dymo Connect is the name of the software that communicates with the printer. Don't forget, you don't have to use this software, which you'll see later. I'm going to recommend you hardly ever use this software unless there's some specific reason, just for convenience, that you need to use this software. But most of the time, we're going to be printing directly from Chrome, because Windows treats this as a normal printer, and that is what's so important about this printer. It doesn't need its own software. You can print directly from Chrome as you're viewing your label, so that speeds up workflow and saves you time. But what I'm doing here is just installing the software, because it needs the driver in the background. And we're going to test the printer to make sure it works. If it works in the software, it's going to work in Chrome as well. So, now that the driver's installed, we can plug it in. So here's the power pack, lovely long cable on it. I've got mine coiled up for convenience, but this side of the power is a common figure 8 connection. So if you need additional length, you can just buy a longer one of these cables, and you know, it's 240 volts on this side. So, or if you're somewhere else, it might be 120. Alright, power's on, power's in. That was, did you hear that then, that motor? That was pulling in the what it thinks is a new roll, but there's no label counter, so it doesn't matter. And we're going to plug in the USB. Alright. So, Why does it say that? Well, that's good that we've got a problem to diagnose, because if you get this problem, then I can help you work it out. It's a chance that I've got it inside a bad USB port on my iMac. I will check that in a minute. I'm just going to unplug it and plug it back in again for now. Also, I haven't restarted the computer since installing the drivers. It shouldn't really need to do that. So I've unplugged it and plugged it back in. USB device not recognized. It's probably my computer. I hope so. So let's unplug that and plug that into there. And plug that into there. Maybe, yes, there you go. That pop-up is from the see, it's installing now. That was just my iMac. Because Apple make amazing products. Now this isn't going to work. This is definitely an iMac problem, I promise you. I am familiar with this computer. I've had it for years, since 2013. So it's nearly 10 years old. So there's four USB ports on the back of this computer. For some reason, the one closest this way works more reliably than any of the other three ports. So now I've had to unplug the keyboard and the mouse and plug it into a different port. I can see that it's picked up on the printer just fine. So let's try another port for my keyboard and mouse now. Yeah, right, cool, we're good. Apple make amazing products. You'll never see a review video from me for them. Anyway, as you can see down the bottom left here, Dymo Laborator 4XL. That means that it's detected, said virtual printer earlier on. It is detected and it is now working fine. So, it's all automatic and completes the install with no configuration needed by the user. Once the drivers are installed, we can then connect our Dymo Laborator 4XL to the computer, where Windows will automatically detect the printer and link up the drivers, as you saw just now. Okay, well, since it's all working, for old time's sake, let's do a Windows test print, just to see what it looks like on a label this small. So let's go to Control Panel. So this iMac is running Windows 8.1, so it might look a little bit different if you're using Windows 10 or Windows 11, but essentially they all behave the same way. So I'm going to go to Devices and Printers, and here's the Dymo Laborator 4XL. I'm going to right click on that and go to Printing Preferences, Advanced, and we're going to set the default label. I'm pretty sure that these 4x6 inch labels is there, 1744907, 4x6, okay, and okay. So now we've set the default label size so it knows that it's usually going to be the large label. All right, so let's see if we can do a test print. Print test page. So it says it's out of paper, but I know it's not. It's because I didn't press this button on the front. Okay. Oh. There we go. That's because I messed about with the thing. Let's do that again just to show that everything's fine. It's because I pulled the reel out earlier on, that's all. So let's try printing a test page. There we go. That's how it should have been. Did you notice how fast it is? That's what I like about Dymo specifically. It's not just the hardware, but it's the effort they put into the software. How quickly the computer is able to render the print job and send it to it over USB. The computer's got to do a little bit of thinking. It's got to speak the language that the printer works on. So anyway, if you've ever seen a Windows test page before, this is what it looks like on a 4x6 sheet. There it is. Ta-da! What have we got here? Did it say? I was wondering if it would say the type of signal that's being... Oh yeah, RAW. So that's actually being sent RAW. RAW! Cool. So, it works. Did you see how quickly and easily it was to set up? Did you notice? So, now that we know that's working, let's do a quick test in the Dymo software, just to show you how the Dymo software works. It's pretty simple. You can choose the labels here, change label. I feel like I'm doing it wrong. It's because I never change the label size, I've forgotten how the software works. So I'm gonna go to new, Second printer, yeah, we know. Then we're going to choose a label from here, 4x6. I've gone past it, haven't I? I think that's the one. Extra large shipping labels for writer XL. Right. You can choose here now, landscape or portrait. Open. Lovely, there it is. It's giving me little tips and stuff like that. I'm going to press this button, which zooms me out to see the whole thing. I'll come out a little bit more so we can... I've changed the resolution of this screen so that the recording is easier, which you can see on the screen. So let's just do some test stuff. I'm going to put that there. Check this out. This is really cool. You can actually do QR codes in the software without having to go to some website. So, and you could make it a web page, for example. So if we went www.google.com, add, you meant to press the add button here first. And you get an actual scannable QR code which any phone or device can scan. Let's go see, it's updating live as we type it, right? That's how quick it is. So then if you scan that, it'll take you to google.com. Now that's super useful if you're making your own labels and nothing to do with postal labels. That's really useful, right? So watch how quick it is. And if you really want to test this, get your mobile phone out right now, or a second one if you're watching this. I'm going to hold this up for a couple of seconds. You could even scan the screen or scan this. I don't know if I'm going to be able to hold it still enough for you. Yeah, if I just hold that there for a few seconds, just so you can try scanning it with your phone for a laugh, just to see if it takes you to google.com. There it is. 3, 2, 1, and you're back in the room. So, that's working. So, the coffee's definitely starting to kick in now. So the Dymo software works, right? You can do a normal barcode as well. I mean, you know, it's obvious stuff. It works. Blah, 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 right? Let's close down the Dymo software. Because the interesting thing is here. These two boxes, it's not just an unmessy room. This is two parcels that need to be sent today. I'm going to show you two methods of printing a postal label. As you can see here, I have two parcels that need to be posted out. This small one is a sale I made on eBay. So for that, I'll need to print a packing slip and put that inside the box. And then I'll print its postal label generated by eBay. This much larger parcel is a PlayStation 5 that needs to be sent to Sony for repair. Now that label's already been generated for me and it's been sent to my email address. So that'll be printed a little bit differently. I'm going to show you just how versatile the Dymo Label Writer 4XL really is, as there may be some occasions where you'll need to print a postal label that was not generated by eBay. So Royal Mail, Parcels to Go, Hermes, Amazon, etc. It can do them all. So, beginning with the eBay label, we're going to print two things. The postal label, and to save time messing with the full-size printer, we can even print the packing slip with the Dymo Label Writer 4XL. And at the same time, we can save some trees. So if you're going to be printing a lot, then this will really save you money on paper and ink costs. Rather than printing a full-size A4 sheet, you can squeeze it all onto one of these labels, chuck it in the box, and it does the job. So, let's go to eBay and find the label that we need to print off for this parcel. There it is. So it's a wireless charger and I don't need it, so I thought I'd sell it. So, everyone who's sold on eBay is going to be familiar with this page. Purchase postal label. So we need small parcel. And I need to weigh the parcel. I haven't done that yet, so be right back. 580, so we'll go 590 to make up for the tape that we're going to put on it as well. And we're going to select first class. First class, there we go. 395. Paying with PayPal, purchase the postal label. Now, normally, this pop-up would come up and you'd print from your normal printer, right? But now, as you can see, it's popped up and it's given me the option to choose the Dymo Laborwriter 4XL. Now, if this doesn't appear for you, you just click here and you select the Dymo Laborwriter 4XL. It'll be there as long as you follow the previous steps. And you can see on the left-hand side, it looks like an A4 sheet, but it's actually just zoomed in. So what I like to do is just change the scale slightly because it's got this border around it. And let's have a look, fit the printable area. No, we want customized. And we can just nudge this up until there it is. And also make sure it says one sheet of paper at the top right. Sometimes if it's a large sheet and you only want the top left section where the label is, like there might be proof of postage somewhere else around the outer edge, it might spill over to 2, 3, 4 and then you get several pages like you saw earlier on. But the good news here is it says one sheet of paper, so we know it's going to print successfully. Let's click print and look how fast it comes out. There it is. So I'm going to make sure everything's in there. Lovely. There's our label. We'll just slap that on there and it's done. But we haven't done the packing slip yet, and it's slightly different. So let's click open packing slip, because we want to put that in the box before we post it off. Press print, and it won't actually print. It'll just open up the print dialog. So now we can see that there is a border, and we can see that by default, it's got this sort of noise on the top and the bottom, the, what do they call it, header footer. So we want to turn that off. There we go, header footer, lovely. What's background graphics? Nah, don't worry about that. Margins, minimum. Nah, we'll keep that on default. And we can change the scale if we want. You can just play with this and see what you prefer. At the top right here, this is like cut off the edge and the price is cut off the side here. So I'm going to reduce this back down until it looks tidy. And there you go. Happy with that. I mean, you could even do it landscape, right? It's whatever you prefer. It's fully customizable. Make sure that doesn't spill over to two sheets. And there you go, let's print that. Lovely. And there's our packing slip. There it is. So, that goes in the box. We need to seal that up. Let me get some tape. And that's it. It really is as easy as that. Fast, easy to set up. So now let's do the PlayStation 5. So with the PlayStation 5, the label was generated for me by Sony. That's in my emails, so I'm going to go to my emails and it's as a PDF file. So I'm going to have to download that file, do a little bit of magic with it to make sure it prints properly on the label. And here's the link for my return label. So let's go to that. And there it is. So it just so happens that this looks like it's going to let me print it in the same way as eBay allows. Now, sometimes you can't do that because the sheet that they send you has got other stuff around it, such as the proof of postage. So you might have, imagine an A4 sheet of paper, and you'd have the top left quadrant of that would be the label that you'd cut out and stick on your parcel, and then alongside it might be proof of postage, and then the bottom half might be a customs declaration, and that can be a real pain. I could just hit the print button now and it'll be fine, but I'm going to pretend that that's what's happened so I can show you how to handle that. So I'm going to press cancel, and I'm looking at my label on the screen. So what I'm going to do is position it so that I'm not losing any information. So I'm scrolling up and down here and making sure that everything is viewed in the right way. And then what I'm going to do is open up the snipping tool, which is built into Windows. And to do that, I'm going to press my Windows key, type in snip. There it is, snipping tool. And this is the snipping tool. So we're going to press new. The screen will go like that. And then I can draw anywhere on the screen what I want to capture. And we're going to paste this into Windows Paint, and we're going to print directly from Windows Paint as an image rather than text. So the first way that we did it printed it as text. This is going to be the image version of the same. So I'm going to start at the top left and draw a box to the bottom right. And now that is in memory, that is in the clipboard. So I can just minimize this in case we want to come back to it. And now I'm going to open Windows Paint. Paint. And here's Windows Paint. Now I know that my label is in the clipboard in memory, so I can paste this at any time. I'm going to shrink the box down, just in case that when I paste this, the image is smaller than the box. So if I make the box smaller and paste, it'll zoom out the box to the required size needed for the image. So we're going to press paste, and you can see it's just done that. And now let's have a little look. So I'm happy with that for the most part. There's a little black line on the right hand side here, so I'm just going to close this in slightly. And the same for the bottom. Brilliant. So now I'm happy with that. There's a bit of a shadow line at the top there. So what I'm going to do is press Control A, which selects the whole image, and I'm going to use the up arrow on the keyboard to shift everything up slightly. There we go, just to get rid of that shadow. And then I click away now to clear the selection. Come back to the bottom, and now I'm happy with everything there. The first thing I'm going to do is tell it what printer to use. In case you've got several printers attached to the computer already, we're going to tell Paint which one we intend to print to. So we click File, we press the little arrow, or we don't click it, just hover the mouse over the arrow next to Print, and we go to Print. Now we're not going to actually click the Print button. So for example, your default printer might have been that or the fax, but for me, it's already defaulted to Dymo Label Writer. So instead of clicking Print, we just want to click Apply. Now that tells Paint that we intend to print to that printer in a few moments. So I'm going to press Cancel, and we're going to go back to File, Print, and then Page Setup. And this, as you can see already, is not correct. It would come out in Landscape, and it would all be shuffled up to one side of the label. So we're going to change the orientation to Portrait, and we can see now that the intended area to print is justified upwards a little bit, so we can center that horizontally and vertically, so that centers the image onto the sheet. And we can shrink the margins, which are the outer part. Now, depending on which label that you use, you might need to add additional margin size to make sure that the image fits on. So if you print and some part of it is cut off, you can adjust these margins so that it all fits onto the sheet. But for the most part, these are already quite excessive, 12 millimeters or nearly 13 millimeters per edge. So I'm going to reduce this to 3 millimeters, and you'll see it updates on the left hand side. So 3, tab, 3, tab, 3, tab, 3. You can see now that the preview image is almost fully expanded to the available real estate that we've got for our label. So now we can press OK, and now we can go to Print. Dymo is already selected, and we press Print. And there you go, that's how you print an image as opposed to a text-based postal label such as what was generated by eBay. And just for comparison, we can now close that, we don't want to save it, and we'll also print this one to show that there's no difference between the two. In fact, this one might be slightly larger because we aren't messing around with the margins. Let's have a look. And there you go. Yeah, pretty much the same. Actually, the bottom one, which is printed directly from the PDF, the delivered by is slightly cut off, as you can see that. So by taking it through Windows Paint, we've kept the delivered by. So check for that when you go to print. Because of the way this label is made, if we zoom out, we might be able to see, and I can't scroll it down. But the way that they've prepared the PDF label for me, everything is right up to the edge of the available space. And as you can see, there's been a problem here because it's cut off the top of that there. So it was better in this instance to screen grab it with the sniping tool or snipping tool and paste it into Windows Paint. Yeah, everything else is fine. And there you go. That's basically that. That's going to go on there and that will be ready to post. Anything, is there anything else worth adding? It's a brilliant printer. I've used it for 10 days short of 6 years. Because I remember going self-employed on the 16th of the 6th, 2016. Because I wanted the sixes in there. Because my name's Damien and I had to pick a date to start. Like, I went to the job centre, they were helping me get up and running with self-employment. I had to pick a date and I was like, I don't know, when shall I go, like, you know? That was like just the logical decision at the time. And I can see it's the 6th of the 6th today. Yeah, it's been near enough 6 years. It's never needed any repair. It's never failed me. It still works and works fine without compromise. It's not broken. It's not like, oh, there's this little problem. Oh, I should get a new one soon. It still works. It's gone through thousands. There's 500 labels on each of these rolls. And I've gone through loads. I could probably look up, actually, because I do my own accounts. I could probably go and find exactly how many label reels I've bought. I wonder if there's a chip inside here that records how many labels it's ever printed. That would be cool to go and look up. I'll have to look into that. It doesn't require proprietary labels. In other words, I don't have to buy the Dymo labels. Are these the Dymo ones? Yeah, these aren't the Dymo branded labels. Because all the Dymo branded ones have got Dymo written on the back. And this one hasn't. You can use any thermal label as long as it's got that notch on it. So, you know, if you go to a third party website, it'll say compatible with the Dymo Label Writer 4XL. If it says that, it'll be fine because all it requires is that little hole there. You can just see that there. Those black lines help it as well. You know, that's how most thermal printers will work. It'll have some kind of indicator to show the start and end point of the label, which is why it messed up earlier on when I pulled the reel out and back in again. I hadn't pressed the button to say, hey, find the start and end point of the next label. How about looking at how fast it prints? Do we want to see that? So let's say you've got several labels to print off. Let's do 10, for example. Let's see how long it takes to print 10 of these labels. It's also really quiet. I reviewed another printer before. The first thing I noticed about it was how loud it was. It sounded like one of those old school dot matrix printers. It was grindy. I'm going to try and find a clip of that video and I'll post it right here. And I swear I'm not going to alter the sound levels or the volume. I'm going to just play it as is. Okay. That was loud and slow. Jizz as well. That's the other amazing thing. It's loud. It's loud. See? It's loud, isn't it? So, but this one is sweet and quiet. Disclaimer, I'm currently using a different phone and a different microphone. I'm using a different phone with a different microphone inside it. So, you know, there's a slight chance of there being a different sensitivity on the microphone between now and the phone that was used to record the video of the other printer. Believe me, take my word for it, it was loud. It's loud! This one is nice and quiet. So, if you're in a shared office, for example, where colleagues, or if you're working from home and somebody else is watching TV and you're busy trying to work, it's silent, near enough silent. It's not silent, but, you know, it's nice and quiet. It isn't a distracting sound. But that other printer I reviewed was just horrendous for so many reasons. that external tray was so stupid. The fan folded sheets, it was so stupid. You know, inside here, it's away. You can, this isn't completely black, this is kind of transparent. I don't know if you can tell, but you can kind of see through it and see how many labels are left. And even if, just lift this up and you can see how many labels are left, it's like, trying to think of other cool things to say about it. It does the job. I suppose maybe I'm trying to oversell it. I mean, it's a label printer without any problems. It's a label printer without any problems. You buy it, it solves a problem, and you don't have to worry about it anymore. It's like, you just pay for it, and it just works. I don't want to rob Apple of their slogan, it just works. But I mean, it does, like, it does just work. Have a look in my video description for a link to Amazon, and that'll show you the latest price. And it is an affiliate link, so if you use that link to buy it, that'll give me a little kickback as well, and that'll encourage me to make more videos and stuff like this. If I've missed something, if there's a question on your mind right now, and it's something I haven't covered, can you do this, can it do that? Ask me in the comments. I know everyone says this, I literally read every comment, purely because not many people comment on my videos. So when I get a comment, I'm quite excited to read it and respond to it. So if there's something specific you want to know, ask, I will reply. If you check out my other videos, you'll see how often I reply to them. In fact, there's already a couple of videos on this printer, which I did a few years ago, and they were quite successful videos. Have a look at the view count on there, like thousands of views. Loads of questions and comments, and you can see that I've replied to them. So yeah, buy it. You won't be disappointed. And if you are, you can always like send it back. But don't. It's a good printer, like, yeah. There was something else I was going to say as well. Oh, like the video as well. That apparently helps, although I don't know how. As far as I'm aware, it's the watch count that actually matters. I don't really know how YouTube's algorithm works. I know it's monitoring something about how many people watch the video, and like more views it has, then it suggests it more, so like it snowballs or something. Subscribe as well. I don't need to tell you to do these things. I mean, you know, you should make your own mind up. Like if you thought this was useful, trying to say stuff that I haven't heard in other people's videos, but it's already been said. Hi, yes, that's right. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you want to subscribe to this video, guess what you do? You hit the subscribe button. What's the other one? The bell. That's right. Hit the bell icon. Apparently that is the best thing to do. Doesn't matter about liking, doesn't matter about subscribing, no. Hit the bell button, don't just ring that bell. Hit that bell, smash. That's what YouTubers say, isn't it? Smash that button. But don't damage your device doing that, because that would be upsetting, isn't it? Like, you know, if you're watching it on a phone and you smash that, if you hit that hard, you're gonna crack your phone, and nobody wants to do that. You know, an insurance claim, oh, what happened? Oh, I smashed my phone. Ah, was it accidental damage or was it intentional? Somebody told me to smash the like button because it's better than just tapping it. And I was so excited with this video, I just went, exploded. I wonder if the insurance claim would actually cover that. Don't know. Gone a bit nuts, even though I haven't finished my coffee. I don't know how it's still warm, I've been rambling on for God knows how long. It doesn't work with mobile phones, but wait, it doesn't end there. You do need to plug it into a PC, or a Mac, or a laptop, or a MacBook, and you can't plug it into an Android or an iOS device. But I have made a Wi-Fi box for this printer. So you literally plug it in underneath and it gives it Wi-Fi. Now you can't plug it into a PC at the same time because the box takes up the USB port. Haven't got one to show you, I don't think, but I have got an empty box. I haven't put the electronics in it. I build them by hand, hold on. Yeah, so I 3D print these and I put some electronics inside here which I've programmed myself to be able to do it. This is one that's sort of warped on the 3D printer and you can see the corners are raised up a little bit there. So this is an empty box and it's destined for the bin. But when it's when it's complete, it sort of looks like this. And, you know, so the Wi-Fi icon there, and there'd be two plugs sticking out here, and in the side there, you'd plug your power into there. If you go onto my videos and type in Dymo, you'll only see like four or five videos, and the one I'm talking about will be two of them. So you'll see like a demonstration of this, but basically it goes in like that, and it would stay there, but those connectors aren't there. So plug that in like that, and that sort of sticks out then. And then you plug the power into there, and you put that down, and then it hooks onto your Wi-Fi. There's like a memory card in the back, it'll go into there with your router's Wi-Fi password, so when it gets powered up it connects, because there's no screen on it. It's essentially like a little mobile phone built in, so it'll connect onto your Wi-Fi, and then your phone will be able to print it. So if you don't have a PC or a laptop, or you just want to be able to print postal labels from your mobile phone, you can do it from your phone, and it'll go through your router, as long as, because that'll connect to your router, your phone connects to the router, and it will see it over the Wi-Fi. No special software needed for Android phones. iPhones and iPads need an app called Quick Print, which is free. You can just download that, and that will talk to the box properly, and then you're printing wirelessly. No need to buy the LabelWriter 5XL, because it's got its own problems. This has a higher price tag than the newer 5XL. This is the LabelWriter 4XL, and Dymo's latest 5XL has a lower price tag. Can you imagine why that might be? Apparently, Wi-Fi problems, because it's got Wi-Fi. It's got what I've got here, but built in, but apparently there's problems with it. Two, proprietary labels. You can only use Dymo's labels in the 5XL. The 4XL, you can use third party or Dymo's labels, the large ones, the small ones, it doesn't matter. By the way, in case it's not obvious, you can use smaller labels with the 4XL, right? Because that's what that adjustment's for. I won't take it out now because I use this. But you'd take that off, you'd put this on, and that spool, you'd close it down nice and tight to the smaller sizes, and then you just select the smaller size label on the computer. There we go. It's a good printer, it does the job, it works, it's reliable, it's cheap to run, it doesn't break, unless you drop it on the floor, I suppose it would break then. I've never tried it, I'm not going to. But if you do want to see that video, I'd need some donations for that. Yeah, if you can get 10 people to donate 25 quid, I will do a destruction test. I've never done one of those before. So if you think that would be an interesting video, put it in the comments. Yeah, I'd pay 25 quid for that, and if I can get 10 people to donate 25 quid, I will do a destruction test video. I don't know why that would be interesting. It might not be. It's not exactly a PlayStation. Has anyone ever been so annoyed? It'd be like a scene from Office Space. I will do a slow motion destruction video of a Dymo LabelWriter 4XL if I can get 10 people. Like, and I'd put the song to it. If you have no idea what I'm talking about right now, go and watch a film called Office Space. In fact, you can just type it into YouTube, Office Space printer scene, and they smashed the printer up. Hilarious. I was howling, crying as a kid, how funny that was. It's a great scene. I might even put that up right now.
But the ghetto, taking short steps, 1 foot at a time, and kept my head low and never let go. Cause if I let go, then I'd be spineless. I'm going insane.
I think my mind just goes out of control and touch on subjects motherfuckers don't read about. I touch on this shit they be leaving out. I seen this motherfuckers not smoking. I seen the same. I bet you motherfuckers will too. Because it's time, motherfuckers die, motherfuckers still fool.
I'm I think it's something in the water, man. It's got to be in the water.
Jumps on a killer spree again. We're guillotined for men. I walk around town with a frown on my face. Up the whole world, finna get the murder case. The murder rate.
There you go. Have fun, everybody.